Hello, everybody. I hope you're all doing well today. Let's see what we get into.
Put together this grand light mercury vapor fixture yesterday, so there'll be a video of this coming soon. I put it together. It's brand new because I wanted to use it at work. So we'll be bringing it there and putting it to use. Found this at the Value Village yesterday. I've always kept my eye out for one of these older fiber optic lamps. I love these things. They're getting very hard to find nowadays. You can find a lot of, you know, just battery-operated cheap plastic ones. That's really all you can find. This one's definitely older. It has a chromed bottom piece here. Pretty neat. And it came with a broken halogen bulb here. I believe it's an MR11 12-volt bulb, 10 watt. And it uses a 12-volt AC adapter, not DC, AC. So need to find a special adapter for that because it did not come with it. And here's the inside. So there's some screws at the bottom. You just undo those and the whole thing comes out so you can replace the bulb. Of course, that goes right there in the middle and those little springs hold it in place. And we have the color wheel with the little synchronous motor. So you can see the different colors there. So very simple. Oh, it wants to tip over because we have the fibers up here. But the interesting thing about it is that it uses this little jack that looks like a headphone jack for the power, which is quite annoying. I've seen this before on some other novelty lamps. I don't know why they chose to do that. But the power adapter that I went online to find, because you know, it's not often you find a AC to AC adapter. It's usually AC to DC. So I located a 12 volt AC adapter that is 1500 milliamp, and this is 1000, so we're good there. And it has a barrel jack, a standard barrel jack connector, so obviously that won't work with this. Now I could just cut the end off and hardwire it to the assembly here. That's one option. Or I can keep that barrel jack and find the opposite end to put in the housing here. So that's exactly what I did, is find the other end and put it into the housing. So we're all good there. So we got a new plug coming, a new adapter, and I got some new bulbs coming as well. So that'll be fun to put together once everything shows up next weekend. Next, I picked up some pull chains here and stuff for the new ceiling fan that we put up in the guest bedroom area. I wanted something easy for them to tell the difference, so obviously the fan and the light, I thought that's kind of neat. We'll use that in there. Got some more chains. You can always use more chain and these little guys here because I don't know if that comes with any of it. But it's amazing how expensive this stuff is. This thing was $10, and then this together was $10. I don't know. Everything's expensive. And finally, picked up these bulbs here at the ReStore. These were in a box for free with a whole bunch of other CFLs and incandescent bulbs, but I decided to pick these out. So we got two of these here. I'm actually going to save those for last because they're the most unique, I think. Here we have a Philips LED bulb. It was the only LED bulb in there. Well, actually, there were some older Lights of America ones, but I have no use for that. I have no use for this either, but I thought for free, if I ever do need one, at least I have it. Just a Philips 12-volt bulb there for a halogen replacement. Thinking of halogen, here's a Philips 100-watt halogen bulb. A Philips T21-shaped three-way, 50, 100, 150. This is a longer life version. Here we have a GE clear incandescent. I'm not entirely sure what wattage because the etch is pretty much gone. And I can see a zero on it, so it's either 40, 60, or 100. And a GE 250-watt heat lamp. Well, there was an etch on it. I don't know. We can't see it, but it's there. Oh, it just can't focus on it. There it is. Not bad for free. It's brand new. And back to these two. These are interesting. These have halogen bulbs inside, as you can see, and CFLs. So how these worked is the halogen bulb would turn on first, allowing you to have instant light while the CFL warmed up. Once the CFL got to a certain brightness or time limit or whatever it was, the halogen bulb would turn off and leaving the CFL on. So that was their solution for an instant light for a short amount of time. GE did something like this. I have a daylight version and a plant light version, just because those were cheaper at the time. So these are both soft white. I don't know if they work, but hey, for all these things being free, I'm not going to complain too much.
I'm not much of a person to buy stuff on Amazon constantly. I tend to just save up items in the cart and then buy it all at once when I need a particular item sooner than later. So inside the box, we have a variety of things rather than just, you know, one thing at a time. I also feel that cuts down on, you know, wasted gas for the postal services and stuff, because they can all put it in one box instead of having to ship, you know, five or six littler boxes. Anyway, we have a variety of things inside here, so let's go ahead and see what we got. Oh, we have some very nice packing material. That's always the best. I love how everything's just kind of thrown in here. I ended up getting a new multimeter type thing here. I always wanted one with the clamp on it, so this is wonderful. It came with a whole bunch of other things in this bundle here. Of course, these things aren't exactly that accurate, but it'll be nice to have some of the other items on here as well. Of course, this is a well-known brand, so I don't see any problems there. That'll be fun to use. This is not anything to do with electrical or lighting. It is a popcorn maker. My friend back home has one of these, and he used it quite frequently while I was visiting him, and it worked really well. So I thought I'd pick one up so I can try it out myself. And when he comes out, we have popcorn for him. Okay, this is something I've been waiting to get but just never have, is some more Philips Hue colored bulbs. I've wanted some more of these to use down here in the basement, but I've just never done it. Looks like this seal's already broken. Maybe that's just from, you know, being crushed in the box here. Well, they don't really pack that too amazing, do they? They just kind of sit there. Anyway, they look new to me. I have one of these where the base, I believe, is metal, so I wonder if they've changed it over time. Maybe that was a very old original Philips Hue bulb. But this will be wonderful for some of the lights down here in the basement. Okay, and then these last three things is what prompted me to order this other stuff that was in the cart. So here we have an AC adapter, not a DC adapter. This should be 120 volt AC to 12 volt AC, and in fact it is. This is for the, oh boy, I can't think of anything. This is for that fiber optic lamp that we got last weekend that was missing its power adapter. Now obviously this is different than the power adapter that it has. So I picked up what is hopefully the correct size plug here. I might as well find out right now. You had to get them in a pack, and I mean they weren't too much, so no big deal there. Just move that box out of the way. I really hope this fits. Oh, thank goodness it does, because that'll look much nicer than just a cord cut off and wired in directly. Wonderful. Okay. Set that aside. And last but not least, some little bulbs for inside the fiber optic lamp. I thought I had some. This looks like they just put it in there to cushion the bulbs. I did have one, but it's not the right wattage. It's 20 watts that I got at the Restore or whatever in that huge box of bulbs a couple years ago. This was in there, but this is 20 watts, and the fiber optic lamp had a 10 watt one in it. So these are little 10 watt bulbs, same size and everything. So a variety of items, Philips Hue bulbs, the
the little plugs here. It looks like these can be, you know, plugged up too for like weather resistance. We got this wonderful power adapter, the popcorn thing, and then of course the electrical meter. Okay, now of course we need to put the fiber optic lamp together. After all, that is why I placed this order. Okay, so here's the fiber optic lamp again. I believe we've already taken a look at it. I just don't remember if I filmed that or not. But of course, we got our little fiber optic fibers, so we'll just take that out and set it aside. And the whole assembly here in the middle just pulls right out. So there's our assembly. Got some screws and stuff inside. There's the old washers and whatnot for the old power adapter. Now, this bump right here, I tried to bump back out a little bit. Maybe not that good, but it's better than it was. Of course, we'll need to take off this sticker here. We don't need that on there forever. I'm always hopeful that when taking these kinds of things off, it doesn't leave too much residue behind, but I'm sure it will, just like everything. And of course, these are like those security stickers that are super annoying. They got the little slits in them there so that if you remove the tag and try to put it on something else, it'll show up that you messed with it because of the little lines. So we'll get that cleaned up. But I'll clean that up last once we get it all assembled, because it might get dirty again while we are working on it. Okay, so inside here, I'll turn the light that way a bit more. Obviously we have our synchronous motor from Wonderful Company, because I cannot read anything. Oops, you probably couldn't even see that, I apologize. Of course, we have our little socket for the halogen bulb, and this was the plug for the power adapter. It looks like a headphone jack. I have some novelty lamps back home that use power adapters like this. That's probably to prevent you from using a DC adapter by accident on an AC adaptive assembly or something. But as you can see, this is going to be quite easy to remedy because it's just wire nutted on there. And that's what we have these for. So there's nothing on this card. Made in China, I'm not surprised. We do have some things here, and I guess we'll just have some extras for projects in the future. But there's our new plug. Now, I measured, and hopefully it should fit in here. Wow, it does. Boy, you can really find anything on the internet. That is for sure. That'll look great there. Okay. So, I think that needs to be a little longer than the way they got it there. Now, they left it short because I'm sure they'd expect you to, you know, just, oh boy, what was I even talking about? Well, they expect you to just solder it onto something, I'm sure, but obviously we're not doing that. Now, nothing's colored here as to the positive and negative, because that doesn't necessarily matter. We just need alternating current for the motor. Okay, so there's that. Now, like I said, these are kind of short, so we'll go ahead and make them a little longer here. It is nice that they already put some solder and tinned the ends there. Okay, so that's better. So now we'll just wire this back up. Just twist all the little wires here together. I'm not a big fan of these little yellow wire nuts, but let's see how they hold. I always like to give it just a little bit of a tug just to make sure that it's not going to fall out. Okay. Other side here. spare wire nut. But that isn't really holding together like I'd want it to. And then did you realize what I did wrong? You probably realized this a long time ago, and this is something that I do often. This is supposed to be mounted in there first. Oh my goodness. Now I gotta take it apart again. Isn't this just wonderful? You see, this wouldn't happen if I would have been thinking, but I don't think. So that's pretty much all the wiring we need to do. Now, obviously, we need a bulb. As you can see, excuse me, there's these little springs here, and that those clip onto the bulb, as far as I could tell, to help hold it in place. So let's bring them up here. Okay, we have a little box of bulbs here. Of course, like everything on there, you gotta buy it in bulk. I only needed one, but for the price of one at Home Depot, I could get six. So of course that's what we did. There it is. Bulb doesn't look exactly center, but that don't matter. At least it does say on it what it is. Okay, now let's see if we can get it in here. Now, usually you don't wanna be touching halogen bulbs with your hands, but here we go anyway. Now I'm not necessarily touching the halogen bulb itself, I'm touching its outer casing. I don't want to get any fingerprints right on the front of it. I know the socket is good. Oh, there we go. I was gonna say I've gotten it in there before. At least the other one, when I found it, was in there. Now this is going to be interesting. How in the world are we going to get these up there? I don't know if they're necessary other than, like, if you're transporting the thing. Because, to be honest, I think that's why the other one broke. It's because there was too much pressure on it. There we go. Okay, so let's see if we can move those a bit just to get the bulb to go straight. It looks pretty straight right now. Okay, whatever. It's in there. We have the little clips holding it in place. Now, we just need some power, don't we? And we'll see if it works. So we have our AC adapter. Pull the cord apart here. Straighten it out a bit. Okay. Plug that in. And let's plug it into this out front here and we'll turn it on. Here we go. Oh, there we go. Yes. Typical synchronous motor. Had to think about what way it was going to turn at first, but we definitely have action and light. Very cool. Okay, let's see what we can see through here. Yep, there's the light bulb. And all the different colors. Very cool. Okay. Now that we've confirmed that it indeed does work, let's put it back together. Gonna unplug this. Boy, I forgot how heavy some of these things were. Now everything's electronic, you know, DC adapters. Okay. Now, that's good. That's good. We'll place this back in here. There's two holes on the bottom, and they'll line up with some of those holes down there. Doesn't necessarily matter what ones, I don't think. We'll just put it with whatever ones it kind of ends up being with. Look at that. It kind of lined it up
real well. You can kind of see where it used to be there with the two blue dots. I don't know if those are the same holes as before. I don't think so. It looks like this has been taken apart before because there's threads in two of these, but not threads in four of these holes, but not threads in these here. So someone's opened it at one point and put it back together with different mounting holes, which we are also going to do. Since it doesn't necessarily matter. Okay, I'm just gonna hold this off camera for a second to get some better grip on this. There we go, okay. There it is. Yep, and it's kinda, it's freestanding there. Okay, we're almost there. We have our bunch of fibers here. So let's go ahead. I'll put some of this stuff away here real quick. Okay, so we'll take the rubber band off of here. Here we go. Yep, there. That is it. Very fun. Look at that, isn't that cool? Okay, plug our adapter in there. Plug it into the wall. Here we go. Awesome. Okay, obviously we have to turn off the lights. Oh, that is so cool. How wonderful is that to see working? Okay, let me kind of put it somewhere else here and we'll take a different view. There it is. Awesome. Take a quick look at some of the finds this week. I found these for a dollar a piece at the used building material, second use place. They clip onto an R30 size bulb and it gives the barn doors or whatever they call these. I forget the exact name. So that's pretty cool. I've never seen anything like that, that you can put on a incandescent or halogen R20 size bulb. I put a bulb in it, definitely fits using one of them that they had there. So that was pretty cool. Here is a Designer's Edge photo cell. Interesting. Bellevue, Washington. Huh. Brand new in package. So that was a dollar. You can always use another photo cell. Here, this is from another place. I picked up this ElectroPack side light. It's a 12 watt preheat fluorescent globe fixture. Look, it even has ribs on it. That's pretty cool. I haven't seen one like this. It's brand new in box. Looks like it was originally from Fred Meyer for 20 bucks. I picked it up for 10. Seems a little high to me, at least for my standards of finding things, but how unique it is and it's brand new, I thought it was worth it. On the side here, there's three of these Westinghouse Ceramalux 150 watt high pressure sodium lamps. These are quite early. You can see the design. They even have writing on the arc tube there. However, this is during the transition period because it does say Philips Westinghouse on it. Pretty cool for a dollar. There are three of those, so I picked up all three of them. And then here is a Sylvania metal halide 150 watt bulb. Picked this up for a dollar. Can always use another one of these and some of the floodlights. And last but not least, this 70 watt GE high pressure sodium bulb for 50 cents because that color tag was on sale. Not bad. There was one other thing. Oh yes, here it is. I was gonna say, I set it down somewhere. It's this Lithonia dual F20 T12 fluorescent rapid start fixture.
That's where it originally came from. And it's all brand new. It uses the lamps on the side. So you'd have one on this side and one on the other side instead of just one lamp in the center. But everything's in there. I checked and made sure. This tag was 75% off. So what, $2.50 for this brand new fixture. Very cool. Definitely will find a home for that. So those are some of the finds this week. Here's one of those adapters on a bulb. Fits really well. Unbox the meter. Definitely a nice unit. I've already used it a little bit just to test out some of its functions. Super happy with it because, I mean, I'm coming from something like this. I'm still using one of these cheap meters from Harbor Freight, and yeah, there's not even a terminal for this end. So this is a huge upgrade. Let's put together this Lithonia dual lamp fixture here. So there's the sticker on it. And what's inside? We have our end caps. Note how they're bigger here because there's no socket. There's not going to be a socket on the ends there. And we have both of our socket sets already put together. Our bolts and stuff, I believe, for the grounding. Here's another one. Maybe it's for something else. Maybe, I don't know. It's another grounding set. Here's our little clip to hold the cover on. And of course the ballast. Let's take a look at that. It's an Advance 42 F20 T12 F15 T12 or F15 T8 preheat lamps in a rapid start circuit. Very nice. Okay, so we got to put these sockets in at the ends here. I'm going to kind of curl up some of this wire. There we go, there's one. Because we don't need all that extra wire hanging out. And that's what the ends are going to look like. Of course, you have to do the same thing here to the other end. So this one doesn't want to slide in there as nice. Let's try the other side. Oh, there we go. I wonder what's going on here. I mean, they do have this bent in a little bit, and I'm guessing they did that to hold the lamp holder. I'm going to take it off the camera here for a second and just see what's going on. So if I wiggle it in a different way, better, but still it needs to go in further. It's not in all the way. Okay, there. Pretty snug, but we got them in place. Here's our end pieces. One of these I'm going to put a hole in to put a switch, because I'm always putting switches on things like this. Got to have a way to turn it off and on. Of course, there is a spot here for a switch, but we won't be able to use that because of the bulbs being on the sides. Okay, so I drilled a hole in one of the end plates here that is the perfect size for the switch. Very nice. And we'll put the end on here. Looking good. Now, of course, we got to take this out. Probably should have done that first so that we can put our cord in. Usually, I like to put the cord and the switch on the same end just because, well, there's less wiring that needs to be done. They're close together. So, okay, yep, definitely going to have to pop that out of there. So let's get a, here we go. You just make sure none of the wires will be in the way. Put that back. Okay. Now, it's still very much on there, so we'll take our even those pliers here and just bend it back and forth. Loosen it up. There's one side, and there's the other. Very nice. Okay, we don't need that. Throw it away. Of course, we need some type of clamp there. So that's why I buy these things in bulk, because somehow I end up going through lots of them. Somehow, just somehow. Excuse me. Okay. So take that off. Put that in here. Sorry, wrong way. Let's see. That's going to be the top. Let's do it this way. Actually, if we do it that way, you know, I like to look. If the screws are clamped all the way, will it, you know, go past? It doesn't look like it. So that's the way that we'll do it. Like I said, probably should have put this on first and then put the switch in, but that's what we're doing now. So, whatever. Okay. I like to get it just kind of tight enough and then, twist it into place. Get it as tight as I can. And then just use friction to put this where it needs to be. There we go. It's a little off-centered. Gotta have everything just so, you know. Okay. Looking good. Now, I need to find a grounded cord, because naturally we want to have this grounded, being a rapid start. So I'll go and find one of those. So here's the cord that we're going to use. This is perfect because it already has a little eyelet hole here for the ground. I get these off of LG washers at work. We go through so many of them that get parted out. And I just keep the cords. So there's a never-ending supply of cords, thankfully. But I'll go ahead and get this tag off of here and clean it up. And we'll move on. Okay, we got the cord all cleaned up. Got the little ferrite core thing off of here. Got the little restraint off of here as well. That thing's a pain to get off, but you can get it off and the cord cleans up real nice. Got the plug off of the end there. So we got a nice heavy gauge cord here. I'm not entirely sure. I'm just taking a quick look. Some little things off of the wire here. The wires, they're just scraped a little bit. They're not cut in or anything. What gauge is this? It says 16. I guess. Anyway, of course we need to put that through here. And I know that we're not going to need a lot of this, so I'm going to just go ahead and clamp it down here at the moment. There we go. So now, obviously this just slides into the end there when we're ready. We need to strip these wires here. Of course, we need some wire nuts. So let's go ahead and get some. So obviously, we have the power in here, the black wire that needs to go to one of the switch leads. So we'll bring them together here. Like so, take our wire nut, put that on there. Again, I just do a little tug to make sure we're good. Okay, now, excuse me. Now we have the other lead of the switch goes to the ballast. And I don't know why, but I'm real picky about how long these things are. It has to be like just right, or else I feel like it's not correct. So we'll bring these two together, because the the solid core wire is going to want to overpower the stranded. So we make it a little shorter than the stranded one and try to twist them together there. Okay, we got our wire nut. Very good. Okay, now, of course, we need the ground. The ground is important. So, for whatever reason, we have two packets here. This one has some extra things going on. We'll just use this one. Maybe they threw in two by accident. I'm not sure. So we'll take out the little washer and this here. So thankfully we already have this guy. So we just need to put him on there. And normally this would go on top to kind of hold the wire down and around. You can see how it's kind of curled in there to help hold the wire. But we have this already done, so I'm not going to even use that. Okay. There we go. We got the ground attached. Very important again for the rapid start circuit. And now we just need to put the end in place. So that just slides in here. Oh yeah, I didn't even think about the fact that the lamp holder is right here with the switch, so infinite wisdom again. Yeah, that's going to be a problem. Let me see what we can do about that. Can we put the switch at a different angle? Okay, let's try it again. Hopefully we don't have enough room now. And the answer is probably not. Oh, that's annoying. Yeah, definitely thought that one through. Cover even slides into place there just fine. And okay, yeah, I think we'll be just fine, actually. We'll be okay. Thankfully. Okay. So, of course, the other end just slides into place. And I guess there's a little bit of a gap over here too. It's not just the one side with the switch. So there we go. We have the ends put on. Okay, and that's the extra stuff there. Now we had, wherever it went, the little clip that holds the cover on. I really prefer these over the American fluorescent ones that clamp the sides of the fixture. This is just a much better idea. So this just goes through here. And then what we need to do is slide the one end in. There we go. Kind of squeeze the fixture together there a bit. Push this end in and give it a turn. Now, sometimes it's kind of hard to turn, so I use some pliers here. There we go. It's always going to scratch the surface. That's nothing new. But yeah, there's our dual F20 T12 fixture. Of course, you're going to need to test it out, so let me get some lamps. Got some Phillips bulbs here. There we go. Reminds me of a fixture I made when I was much younger out of a 2x4. So we'll turn on the switch here and the power. Okay, so it must not be on yet. Let's try the pull chain. Yeah, there we go. Oh, good. I mean, the bulbs are new. I'm not entirely sure how we're getting this effect. Oh, real nice pull chain. I'm gonna have to get a different one. I knew this one was garbage. Well, it works. Yeah, we'll go from here. Oh, there we go. Whatever. Could be because they're brand new bulbs. I didn't see what kind of power factor this ballast was, but it's not the brightest thing at the moment. Quiet though. Yeah, super quiet. So, let's try the switch again. You have to push it in just to reset it. It's ridiculous. That comes right to life. Yeah, we need a different switch. Ooh, that sounded great. Yeah. But there's our, oh boy, Lithonia fixture. There's the sticker on the end. I don't know if we looked at that earlier, but there it is. Not bad for $2.50. While out and about yesterday, found this clip lamp at the thrift store for $5. I decided to pick it up because I don't really have a clip light like this. I have a whole bunch back home, but I don't really have any out here just for, you know, construction or whatever purposes. So this is a well-built one. It has the nice big clamp on it. Much more heavy duty than the typical ones with just a sprung wound, you know, clip up here and then, you know, just clips. This has much more going for it. It is made in China, wherever it came from, but it's one of those with a longer cord as well. I want to say it's like 10 feet or something. So all those extra features make it worth it. It does say up to 150 watts. I'll probably just put some really bright LED bulb in it or something, but that'll be great for little projects. And of course, I ended up getting a new pull string switch for the fluorescent light. So we'll go ahead and put that in. Pick this one up at Lowe's. Usually I get them at Home Depot, but I was closer to a Lowe's, so I picked this one up. Big packaging for such a small thing. This was in the electrical section. It was a dollar cheaper than the exact same thing, of course a different, you know, SKU, in the ceiling fan section. Exact same switch. You can look on the back and you'd look at it and be like, oh yeah, same switch. But they wanted a dollar more for it in the ceiling fan section because that makes sense. So the switch has moved to positions. It wasn't really that good right here anyway, because as you can see, or as it was before, I mean, a bit of the socket is right there, like in the hole area. And the reason I originally put it there is usually that is absolutely fine because the socket is right here. And there's plenty of room on the side over here, but obviously this is a different style fixture. It does not work there. So I gave some thought to it, and its optimal position is usually if you're, you know, it's hanging on the ceiling, you want to pull it straight down. So we'll put it right where the socket used to be, or would be if it was a single lamp fixture. And I moved it over just enough so that it would be as close to the shade here, or the shade, the cover when closed, but not too close where it won't let it close. So that gives enough room over here for the clamping device and enough room for this clamp as well. It's just enough, but that works great. So now we have a functional switch. Now it just needs to find a home. Here's its new home. Fits well here, just have to do some cable management. But I decided to put it here because it's low profile enough and there's plenty of space that when the fan is in use, it doesn't hit it. So that's wonderful. And it gives some light over here because I used to have that little fluorescent here, the F15 T12. But I don't know if I've already mentioned or not, I have moved them up high. I acquired another one recently, and so I decided to put them up here to add some light up high, and that works well. Again, the cord here, or the string, is just short enough that the blades don't touch it, so I can turn them on and off. Wonderful preheat. So that looks great up there, but then there was no light over here again. So this works good here. Now these bulbs, as you can see, have a lot of use on them. They came from the, I think it was the Lights of America wraparound fixture is where these came from. And they really would not start in that fixture at all. So I decided to put them in here. If I change the ends around so that these really darkened ones are at opposite ends, it'll start. If I have them both on the same end, it will not. But it does start fine. It rapid starts its way right up if they're opposite like this. But as you may or may not be able to tell, it is incredibly dim. I looked at the ballast. I don't really know the power factor of it, but these bulbs are really dim. So let's try the new Philips ones that we had originally. Here's the Philips bulbs. I'd say they're definitely a little bit brighter. Not as bright as I would expect out of a fixture like this. I wouldn't say it's as bright as a preheat either, so must be low power factor or something. But what I'm going to do is preserve these bulbs, since they are new, and I will use the GE bulbs that we had in here a minute ago and just see how long they last. One thing I did notice is, as you can see here, the little filament of the cathode, electrode, whatever, is just sitting inside the bulbs. So I'm not sure what end it came from, but they're definitely broken off, at least on one end. Maybe that's why it has trouble starting when they're both in the same side.
As always, I really do hope you enjoy these videos, and also please comment, rate, share, and subscribe. Thank you very much for watching.